Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Okay, how are we doing? Come on, come on. Yeah, some more noise. Come on, I told all the folks in Microsoft, when you guys show up here, there'll be so much noise that they better run somewhere else because they can't handle it. Well, you can't even make a little noise, so let's hear it from everybody. There you go. All right, good. So I want to sort of say first congratulations for being the participant in this first tournament or, you know, competition. I think if it, I have to tell you this, I was in the grading room with all the graders and the volunteers, and I am shocked. So here's what happened. So last night I took this test myself, all right? And I scored myself. And then I came here very depressed. And I thought, oh man, I can't score. What are these guys gonna do? They're seeing it for the first time. But you know what? Most of you scored more than me. So obviously, something is amazing. So it was, they're still tallying up all the scores, but it was phenomenal. It was just really, really cool. I mean, the amount of work, you know, I didn't actually look at the team, but I didn't look at the individual tasks. But it was great. You guys are just phenomenal. Now, also, remember, this is the first time we're doing this, so if this all works out well and we are able to somehow pull it off, you can, as you grow older, you can sort of look back and say, you know, we were the first, we were the pioneers, we made it all happen, right? Because of you, if we will sort of end up thinking, yeah, maybe this can be pulled off. Okay, so I won't say more now. This is how it's going to play out. So I'm going to introduce to you our guest speakers a little bit, and they're going to talk to you a little bit about their passion, and then I'll hand it over to, I don't know, maybe we're going to show some videos or something like that, some fun stuff that they've been doing, and then I'll hand it over to Sana and Jane, who are then going to give the awards out. And we have some beautiful awards here for you, which were done with lots of pain and love, and something that you probably will keep. And also, we have certificates for each one of you. They're also very, very beautiful. So what I want you to do is when you go out, we'll figure out a way, but you should pick up your certificate as you walk out, okay? And this is, I think, also a, sort of a keeper for you as you sort of grow old and look at this stuff. All right, with that, let me introduce the two speakers we have. We have Lennon here, and then Akansha. So let me say a few words about Lennon. So Lennon got his doctorate or PhD from MIT recently, but before he even was doing his PhD, he was also working, he's a sort of an entrepreneur. He has actually worked in companies. He has written a phenomenal amount of code. He actually did an internship in Microsoft Research, and we didn't want to leave him, so we actually gave him an offer right away and kept him for a year, and eventually he said, no, I want to leave. I want to go to get my doctorate and do a PhD. So he's going to talk to you. I was discussing with him what he would like to speak to you about, and he said that, you know, when he was young and he was exposed to all kinds of, like, software and the thrill he got from that, that's the thrill that he wants to share with you. And so he's going to say a few more words about that. But it's great to have him. So let's applaud. Welcome here. And the second speaker we have is Akansha Chaudhary, who's standing right there. Akansha also has a phenomenal pedigree. She, where she came to US from India, there she topped her school, which is a very prestigious school. Then she went to Stanford, got a PhD there, and then she became the only female to have won the Marconi Award, which is a pretty phenomenal deal to have won. And then she's an electrical engineering by training, as opposed to Lennon, who's a computer scientist. So she likes to hack into things, and you will see some of that in action when she talks to you a little bit about and shows you some stuff she's done in the electrical engineering domain. So let's applaud Akansha as well. All right. Okay, with that, I'm going to hand it over to Lennon and enjoy his talk.
Sure. Thanks, Victor. Okay, so today I'm going to talk about what does it mean to think like a programmer. Are you guys programmers? Yeah. What does it mean to think like a programmer?
What to do?
Good. Yeah. Or not? Yeah.
To break problems down into smaller pieces.
Great.
Think what the code is thinking.
Okay, good. I'll tell you it at high level in my mind what does thinking like a programmer mean. It's making the computer do the work for you. Right? If you have an idea, you want the computer to work for you, right? I'll show you a very fun example of what does it mean to make the computer do the work for you, okay? Do you guys know this game?
Yeah.
What is it?
Wordament.
It's Wordament, right? So for people who doesn't know this game, this is how it is, right? You have 16 letters in a 4x4 block, and you should form as many English words as possible, right? And this is me playing. And you can see how slow I am playing. I'm sure you guys are faster than me. Can somebody say what your highest score in Wordament is? What is it?
1,000.
1,000, wow. I'm not going to hit 1,000 here, OK? So at the end of the game, so let me forward here. At the end of the game, when the game gets over, you'll have a ranking like this. Where, OK, so my rank is 492. Look at the first player. Wow, 1,300, right? It's amazing. So this is how the scoreboard always looked like. I'll be in the hundreds, and there are people playing in the thousands. I thought, OK, these people must be superhumans, right? How can they play so fast? And I looked at this video on YouTube of a girl from UK playing Wordament. Look at the speed at which she's playing. I didn't speed up this video, OK? Amazing, right? She is fast. She knows a lot of words in English, and she can do it really, really fast, right? Okay, I'm never going to work like her, right? I don't have the ability to do things like her. So I accepted defeat, okay? I am never going to do well in Wordament ever, right? But I always was curious, what does it take to get to number one and see my name number one there, okay? But I don't have the ability. I can't do English that fast as she could. But I had another ability, OK? I can think like a programmer. That is my superpower, right? If playing that game was her superpower, my superpower was to think like a programmer. So one day, before retiring from Wordament, I just wanted to see myself at number one first. So I sat and wrote a program, OK? I call this the Wordament bot, OK? And this was the result. Look at here. You have only 30 seconds left. My score is 0 right now. OK? And my bot starts playing. Did you hit 1,000? Look at my score. Right? So it's going to show the rank, and you're going to see that, oh, I topped the score. After this, I never played Wordament, but it was a lot of fun. Right? So this was super fun. So this is what is to think like a programmer means. That girl had the ability to think fast, and she knew a lot of words, right? Who is good at it? The computer is good at it. It can think really fast, and if I show it a dictionary, it knows all the words, right? So, and I spent a couple of hours winning the game, right? So this is what it means to think like a programmer. You make the computer do the work for you, right? So when I was asked to give this talk, I initially thought, OK, I'll show you a bunch of cool demos. But I realized, OK, when I was young, what was I inspired by, right? I was very inspired by people telling me, you know what, this is the first program I wrote. OK, and I'll go back home and try to replicate the same program and see, OK, can I write it better than them, OK? So today, I just wanted to give you some of my past history highlights, right? When I was your age, maybe in middle school, high school, very early into college, what programs did I write? How did I become a programmer, right? So I'm going to talk to you about three programs I wrote when I was very young and all the lessons I learned from these programs, right? Okay, so this is the computer I had though when I was young. It had no mouse. It's a text-based, everything is text. It has a very small monitor. I think this was a 286 machine. It used to be called a 286 machine. And the program I used to write, and the language I used to program is called BASIC. It was written by Microsoft when this machine was released. And this is the first program I wrote, tic-tac-toe. Everybody knows tic-tac-toe, right? Do you guys play tic-tac-toe?
Yeah.
Are you unbeatable in tic-tac-toe?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Do you know what it takes to be unbeatable in tic-tac-toe?
Yes.
Yes, good. Okay. So tic-tac-toe is basically you have three rows and three columns, and each player alternates, and they play a game, right? The first program I wrote was a program where you have a player. He plays against the computer. So the computer has to think and play back, okay? And you know, I was very proud that my program was unbeatable, okay? My dad used to play. Everybody used to play against this computer, and it was totally unbeatable, okay? So how did I make it unbeatable, okay, when I was young like you? This is what I did. I'll go, take a paper, draw out every possible game, okay? Look at the game here. So the X is what the player plays, and the zero is what the computer plays. So this is a game which I've written out in a paper, and I used to waste papers after papers, okay, drawing this game out. And you know what? I translated this into a program. This is how it looked like. It says, if move is one, and the player plays here, then the computer should play here. Okay, so it's a long list of if conditions. Do you know why the computer has to play in the middle when the player plays on the left?
Well, you have more chances of winning if you put your circle or X in the middle.
Middle, exactly. That's exactly correct. What I figured out when I wrote papers after papers was that you have to play in the middle if you don't want to lose. If you don't play in the middle, you're going to lose, for sure, if the other player is great, okay? So this is move one. Let's look at move two, right? Look at the number of if conditions. It says, you know what, if the player's first move is here and his second move is here, then go play here so that you don't lose, okay? And another set of if conditions for the third move, okay? So I wrote hundreds and hundreds of if conditions, and still I was very proud, right? You can't beat my computer, okay? My program here, right? So this is what happened. My dad was a programmer, and he told me, maybe this is not the right way to do it. I'll give you a challenge, okay? Instead of doing a 3x3 tic-tac-toe, here is four rows and four columns. Can you write a program for it, okay? I quickly realized it's going to look like that. If I did what I wanted to do, right? And this was wrong. It shouldn't do this, okay? So then my dad sat me down and asked me, what did you do on the paper, okay? And I said, told him, this is what I did in the paper. I enumerated all possible positions in the board, and I picked the best move, and I coded it with if conditions, right? And he told me, why don't you make the computer do this work for you? Why do you have to do this in the paper? Right? And he organized my papers, and he showed me, okay, so now you have a position like this, and you have to play, okay? So you have six possible places that you can play, right? You can play in each one of these boxes here. Why don't you put a for loop and say, okay, I'm going to analyze each one of these positions, and you should let the computer do that, right? And you do this iteratively. Basically, you take a move, and you analyze the next possible positions of what the player would play. And you will quickly realize that if the player plays the best move, you're going to lose no matter what, and this is a very bad move to play, right? So you just put loops. The loops is the key to make the computer work. This is what he taught me, okay? And this was kind of really amazing. So you will quickly realize that this is okay to play, this is bad to play, that is bad to play, these things are okay to play. And the computer will make the decision for you. You don't have to make that decision, right? This is exactly why you have to play in the middle, because the computer will tell you, if you play any other move, you're going to lose, right? So this is amazing. Has anybody written tic-tac-toe in Scratch? Tried? You tried? How did you write it?
It was hard.
It was hard?
Yeah, it was pretty hard.
It was pretty hard, right? So I'll tell you a story, okay? I'm not going to actually lie here saying like, oh, I wrote tic-tac-toe right after my dad explained this to me, okay? I went, started writing a bunch of loops, never worked, okay? I was writing, I think, 9 for loops for 9 moves, never worked, okay? And then I tried after a year, after I took a computer science class, failed it again, okay? And then it took me till high school or even like early college to figure out how to write that program, okay? But it was amazing. Once I wrote the program, I realized, you know what? I'm a programmer. I made the computer do this job for me. And this time, the tic-tac-toe was only 25 lines of code instead of hundreds and hundreds of lines. And can anybody guess how many lines of code was the 4x4 tic-tac-toe?
About like 36.
36. Any other guesses?
Still 25.
Exactly. It's the same 25 lines of code. Right? You don't need to do anything extra. You just change a number from 3 to 4, and the computer would do the job for you. And you change the number from 4 to 5, you can actually make the computer play a 5x5 tic-tac-toe. So this was my first program, right? So this is the valuable lesson I learned from tic-tac-toe. I wrote it over multiple years, as I told you, right? I would do this. After a year, I'll come and like take a stab at this problem again, and I would try again, right? But it made me learn a very important lesson. That is, you can make the computer do the job for you. That's the important lesson that I learned, right? So when you guys start thinking like a programmer, right, this is what is going to happen to you. Any technology that you see, you will see a phone, you will see a Kinect, you will see like a TV at your house, even the refrigerator, you're going to ask this question, oh, how does this technology work, okay? And when you think like a programmer, you're going to think, oh, how can I program it? So when I first saw Vodaman, that's what I thought, okay, how does this game work? And my next question was, it's not how can I play it, it's like how can I program it, right? So that's the mentality you guys are going to have. Okay, so this was my second program. My second program was called PhotoViz, okay? So this is the program I wrote. So this was the point where in our house we replaced this dummy computer into a reasonable machine which was running Windows, okay? So we replaced it from a text-based computer to a nicer computer which can display pictures and videos and awesome things, right? But at this point, I was already a programmer. I was thinking, okay, how does everything work? I was very curious about it, right? One thing I was very curious about was, this was the first time I was seeing photos from a computer, right? So I thought, okay, how does a computer store a photo? I know how a computer stores the text. How does it store a photo? So if you have a photo like this, how does a computer store it? Can anybody tell me?
It stores it by pictures and each color is assigned a name.
Yeah.
And it keeps the names.
Sure.
Stored, and then it remakes a picture every time you open it.
Sure, that's correct. Anybody else want to take a stab? Yeah.
In the bitmap mode, it records every pixel, and each number will be accounting for one color.
Exactly. That's exactly right. So let's look at this picture, right? Let's zoom into this picture. Look at what is happening. What are these things? They're just squares, right? They're just squares which is storing a color, right? And if you put a lot of squares together in row and column, you get a beautiful picture. Can you see that? So this was kind of amazing to me when I thought about it, right? Oh, you can actually make a nice picture out of just a bunch of squares, right? If the squares are small enough, you'll never see them. You'll see it like a beautiful picture. Like it's just in rows and columns of square. My next question was, of course, can I program it? And the answer was, yes, I can program it. And there was this nice 4 lines of code in the language I chose. I think I wrote Java code at that point in time. And you can actually read every square. You can just say, you know, loop through the entire square, which says go through all the width and height, and you can get every color in the square. This was great, right? And with an extra line of code, I could even modify the color in that square. That was even more amazing. Then I thought, okay, I should be creative at this point. And I took a block of colors, and I would just switch the color components. Wherever is blue, I will switch it to green or red or something like that, right? And when you go back, look at this picture, after you do that, it'll look like that. Right? That's kind of amazing. And you can make it look like black and white if you just make them gray. Right? And you can completely make it look like black and white, right? So I call this program PhotoViz, which I had, and I kept adding more features to it whenever I had some time. So I would basically make it look like this. So this looks nicely like a painting. And I would make it look like a sketch. And I would distribute this app to friends of mine, right? Who would do all this, take printouts, and put it in the walls, right? It looks amazing when pictures change this way, right? And I added more features. You can add a ghost to the picture, right? You can add more ghosts to the picture. And I started doing even more sophisticated things. It'll find all the faces in a picture and replace it with a cartoon. So I call this feature like face tone or something like that, right? So this was great. So each one of these features were just 5 to 10 lines of code. That was amazing, actually. So when you think like a programmer, right, in 5 to 10 lines of code, you can be very creative. You can be very creative. Whatever you think, you can go code. You can program pictures. You can program your Kinect. You can program your phone. It's really amazing, right? OK, so the last program I want to talk to you about. This was much later, probably at the end of high school when I was starting college, right? So I wrote this program, which was called Welcome Home, OK? So this was the time when I was really fascinated with pictures, but I went a little further, where we got a web camera at our home, and I was fascinated by cameras, right? So my first question was, of course, how does the thing work, right? So how does a camera work? Can somebody tell me? How is it related to pictures?
So you have a camera, and then, like...
Specifically a web camera, right?
Yeah, or, and then you press something, and then it just saves that. Right?
Okay. Okay. Do you want to take a shot? Yeah.
Well, I think the camera captures the light, and
okay.
then it...
Okay, sure. So that's how you take pictures, right? A web camera specifically, it'll give you a stream of pictures like that, which is changing, right? So when you look at a stream of pictures is a video, right? That's what a webcam is all about. Then I got really fascinated about it. Okay, now instead of one picture, I can work with a lot of pictures, right? My next question was, yeah, can I program it? And the answer again was yes. Like, again, in Java or whatever language I was doing at that point, in 3 lines of code, I can say, you know what, capture. And in a forever while loop, I can say, give me all the frames that has been currently caught, right? So this was also amazing. So I wanted to do something very creative with it. When I can get a stream of pictures from a camera, what can I do, right? So I wrote this application. So this application was called Welcome Home, where I would set up a camera in my room, which is always running, OK? So it will always look at my room. And whenever something changes, OK, from the pictures, especially when I walk into the room, right? It would say, you know what, something changed in the room. Somebody walked into the room. And it would turn on the lights. It would start playing music. It would welcome me into the home, right? So this is the app I wrote, which was a lot of fun. I tried to recreate the app for you. But let's see if it works, right? So let's see. So this is, I tried to recreate this app, which I called it Welcome Home. So this is the app. Here's the camera. It is looking at the wall right now, unfortunately. It's not my room. But here's the deal. As soon as I kind of go enter my room, the lights go on, and the music starts playing. I didn't do anything. Right? This was really amazing, but until it got really annoying to my parents, OK? So. Whenever they walk into the house, let's turn on the lights first. Okay, and whenever they walk in and the maid used to come, this used to go on. Okay? Then I made it a little sophisticated. Only when I go sit before a computer, it would actually recognize kind of, okay, there's a human there or a face there who's actually looking at me, and it would turn on the music. But this was kind of a lot of fun, right? The thing is, I kept this program all through my years, okay? And I have used it for many, many, many different things. The same program. I haven't modified the program even a little bit. But I've used it for many things. Do you guys know what this is? How many people have a bird feeder at home? Great. Okay, so I love birds, and I love bird feeders. In my home, everybody loves birds. So we actually set up a bird feeder. So you know when you set up a bird feeder, it takes birds actually up to a month to actually discover it. Okay, and you set up a bird feeder because you want to see these birds, right? So here is what we did, something that is innovative. We didn't go kept checking whether the birds came or not. All we do is we took our program and we set up a camera near that bird feeder and kind of ran the same program. Okay? And when a bird would show up, it would detect, oh, a bird is there. And I did one thing extra. It would send an alert to my phone. Okay? And this worked one day. Like at 6 in the morning, I got an alert saying, you know what? There is some activity in the bird feeder. Okay? I went, looked at it, and there was a bird. This was amazing. I was very proud of it. It was a very simple program when I wrote when I was young, but I could still make it work, right? And make it work for very useful things. Yeah.
So I'm thinking if you can make this camera program for the birds, there can also be a way to, can it recognize other animals and not just human faces?
Sure. So all I was doing here, right? Is the image changing a lot? Is somebody blocking the camera, right? It's like whether the change in image is a lot. So it'll work for anything, any animals, right?
That would mean it can also block out squirrels.
Exactly, it could find, I mean, when something happens in the bird feeder, it'll say, oh, there's something going on and you can see. Oh, you can write a squirrel detector, that'll be great. It should tell you when there is a squirrel, right? But here's the thing. Oh, yeah, sure.
How do you make it so that it doesn't detect it, or it doesn't alert your phone if the cloud moves?
That's a really amazing question. That's a really good, very good question, okay? So the way this is programmed, right, it is kind of, it's kind of robust to all those changes. So what it does is, when there's a very slow change in the camera, right, it would say, okay, there's no big change that happened right away. So the clouds would move slow, and then we would not, say, generate an alert to the phone, right? Also, a fly would just fly here, right? A bird could just fly here, and you could get an alert. To do that, what we did was, oh, some change happened, and the change has been staying there for a while, right? So we wrote code like that, right? You can always make this work. This is the amazing part about programming, right? So you can always, when you face a problem, there's always a solution to it. But here is what happened, right? So the bird feeder alert came. This is great. But the next day, we had to take it down, OK? Because the birds figured it out. And I would get alerts after alerts on my phone, right? It's like, then it started getting really, really annoying to us, right? So here, this is the lesson I learned from this project I did, which is if you think like a programmer, you know what? You can quickly put things together to solve problems, right? Real-world problems. I put the camera, the computer, the lights, the music, even the phone together to solve these problems, right? So today I write a lot of big programs. I'll tell you. Like Victor said, I've worked for companies which were startups, which are used by millions of people today. Some of my code is in Microsoft products. I write research papers. I do a lot of program on a daily basis. I would have probably written millions of code, right? But the thing is, still, when I go back home, I think about these things, which is, how can I do some simple hacking, right? Which is simply program my home in a way that I can enjoy programming as well. Just that it's not my daily job, but it's my hobby as well, right? So I want to tell you one thing. Today, I still have the Welcome Home app set up in my home, okay? Now that it's a little bit actually sophisticated now. So what I do is, I keep a camera, but I also use my phone, right? So smartphones came like 6 or 7 years back. I was, again, very curious about it. It's like, how does it work? Can I program it? And I've done a lot. All my work is on smartphones these days. So today, when I go into my home, all I do is I shake my phone and the lights would come on. Right? So did you see that? I can show it to you again. I shake my phone, the lights would come on. Right? I would do that. I would, in fact, do this. I'll just like move my phone like this and the brightness would increase. Right? I move my phone down, the brightness would decrease. Right? The brightness went down, and it would increase. Right? So I used to do things like that. So when you go back home today, I want you guys to think about programmer. Think like a programmer, right? Think about what you can program around you, what fun things you can do, what problems you can solve. Actually, that's my talk. It's like if you want any of these things set up, you want to look at my program, just send me an email, right? I'll send you the program. So at this point, I'll give it to Akanksha, who's going to show you really cool things, what she has been doing with a robot and a Kinect and things like that. Yeah.
Okay. So you said you created an app, right?
Yeah.
Well, how many screens does it averagely take to create an app?
That app is just one screen.
Oh, okay. Like, no, I'm saying like average apps.
For average apps, it depends on what average you make. Like, amount of money you make.
No.
The average you want.
Experience means like how many different, like, when you go on the app, like, for example, let's take Instagram, there's like a home page and then there's...
That's right. Depends on the complexity of the app and depends on what you want to do with it, right? We have written apps where it's just one screen, but it's doing very intelligent things in the back end, right? And it would detect driving, it would tell people whether they are driving properly and things like that. So it's going to depend on the problem that you solve.
Say if you got a new phone,
yeah.
Like a window, you switch from like a Windows to an Apple,
yeah.
Would it still detect that if maybe you have to change some code around?
You have to change some code around. Unfortunately, programming for the iPhone, Android, and Windows Phone are all different. But still, you'll end up writing only 10 or 20 lines of code.
My second question was, how many coding languages do you know now?
How many coding languages do I know now? That's a very good question. So I don't keep count. I just look at something I want to program. When you think like a programmer, right, all you think about is loops, if conditions, and recursion, only things like that, right? So you can learn a programming language quickly. So it doesn't matter.
How is it different?
They're not very different. They're all typically procedural. They'll all have loops. They'll all have if conditions. So if you know one language, it's like you know all the languages.
I have a second question. You know, like in some coding languages, there are like you can detect some syntax errors and stuff. How does it detect the syntax errors? So like some don't even know there's a syntax error, and some actually like.
Right. So the languages I use, I typically use what is called a IDE, which is a development environment. So the development environment, if it is actually nice and powerful, it would tell you that there is a syntax error.
Okay.
I'll let Akansha take over the show.
How is everyone doing?
Good.
What programs are you planning to hack when you go back? Cameras? What else?
NSA.
NSA. Excited about robots when they are young. Wow, that's a big crowd. Well, this guy really excited me when I came to Microsoft, and I wanted to see what we can do with it. So I want to talk to you about, if you think like a programmer, you can make the computer do things and manipulate the world. Can you make the robot do things? Yes? Do you think it's hard to make the robot do things?
No.
Yes?
No.
How many people think yes? Okay, so I want to change that notion that it's hard to program a robot. In fact, what we will see is that you can program a robot by using your body. Has anyone used a Kinect before? Wow. What do you do with the Kinect?
So you pretty much move with your arms. You're the controller instead of pulling a controller.
You are the controller. She's right.
We use it as a decoration. We just leave it on top.
Okay, it's a decoration piece. Great. Anyone else?
Well, there is a sensor in the Kinect detects the movement around, like. It has a camera too, so the sensor detects the movement in the background. And then if you're like, for example, you're playing Just Dance, if you move like this, it'll tell the Xbox in the game to say that he did this, so I'll get like 75 points or something.
So what's your name again?
Pranav.
What Pranav just told us was that if I move my hand like this and the game likes that move, then it will give me points. Is that correct?
Yes.
So it can see more than a camera in some sense. Is that correct?
Yes.
So it's not just a camera, it seems, right? It can see my body. It can see my body almost to the point where if you are playing a game, then you can actually control things. You can actually kick a ball. Sorry. Throw a ball or kick a football or play tennis? Has anyone used Kinect Sports? Okay. So, to understand how a Kinect works, it's actually seeing this image. We will just see this in a second, where it's actually telling which joint of my body is where. Does anyone understand what this is? This is your skeleton. Go ahead.
Well, if you look at it, there are two players playing, and each player is doing a different thing, and each player has a different movement.
Mm-hmm.
And if you see, there's like small gaps between like their arms
mm-hmm.
and then their legs and stuff, and I'm pretty sure that's their joints and like the mm-hmm. connectors and stuff.
So these dots, as Pranav tells us, are the things which are the joints. So can I detect my arm here?
Yes. Yes.
Can I detect my shoulder here?
Yes.
So let's see if we can make a program.
Okay, I keep dropping this one.
So I'm going to show you the program where I can make the Kinect run. Okay, so this is black right now. My Kinect is here. And let's see. It's seeing me.
It's like David, this also happens. Everyone, can you see that sometimes Kinect isn't always the smartest and it makes your body go spastic? I put my arm like this. It goes into my body, down into my foot.
Oh, you get it. That's what the Kinect program knows.
It's a bug. See, look, it's doing it. You just put it in and out.
If the hand is hidden behind, so Kinect is seen from this angle. If the hand is behind, then it's not able to see it. You see what I mean?
I know. They can't like disconnect. I mean, like, if
okay,
it's
so
it.
Moving on. So how the Kinect works is that we had a camera sensor. We saw cameras and then it stopped, right?
Mm-hmm.
But it also has an infrared sensor. What infrared does is it sort of gives me where my joints are relative to the camera. So I have additional information which lets me sketch out the entire skeleton of my body. Isn't that exciting?
Yeah.
What can we do with this now? Okay, so let's see what we can do with this. Okay.
Oh, I have an idea. So there are some people developing apps and stuff, just like Glennon said that, like, except that you don't have to like shake or do something with the Kinect. You can just like connect the camera on the top of your, like on your roof or something, and then like detect if like the person is the owner of the house. Like, so like you can set it to like, have a picture of you in it. Whenever it's it detects you, the door mm-hmm. just automatically opens. You can just come in and all the lights turn on.
That's correct. So that's the welcome home app that Lennon wrote, right? But the fun part with Kinect is that I'm going to use my body to program this robot. Would that be exciting?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. So let's see how this robot works.
Excellent. Oh,
no. So robots. They're exciting because they can help us manipulate the world. They can go instead of us going somewhere. Don't you wish that all the tasks that your mom gave you, you had a robot to take care of them?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Hard work builds up your body.
Hard work builds up your body, so they don't want robots. Here.
Okay.
So if you wanted to program the robot, we talked about Kinect, right? The Kinect could tell this is my arm, this is my head, this is my torso. This robot here, it has an arm here, as you can see in this picture. It has an arm here. Similarly for the legs, right? So what I want you to tell me is that can you use the Kinect? Can you use the Kinect to program this guy?
Yes.
I want hands so that I can hear.
Yes, because you will have the same. You can program it so that if you it
has the same joints where your joints are.
Mm-hmm.
So that when the cat sees you move one of your joints, it moves the robot's switch. So
okay, so any other input? That's correct.
So it seems like it would work because it has a joint layout similar to the joints in the Kinect skeletal model.
Right, right. So does that look complicated? No? Yes.
So, you know how the Kinect picks up your body movements and
yes.
it kind of translates them into code and then you can see your character moving and the
So what he's telling us is that Kinect can pick up my body movements, my arms, both arms, my torso.
Yeah, so
I can make the robot dance if I dance, right?
Yeah.
I can make him punch if I punch, and then my friend cannot fight with me because I did not punch him, right? You want us to try that?
Yeah.
We have a volunteer for getting punched. Okay, let's try it. Okay. You have to go down because he is down, but give me 1 second, I'll set up the program. Okay, so let's see.
Oh.
Clearly the robot is listening to me. Okay, so I raise my arms. The robot raises his arms. Okay? Now I go down, it goes down. Now I want to kick. What's your name again? Avi. Avi, okay. Here we go. You are not close enough, Avi. Kick him, kick, but I have not programmed because he might fall. Okay, does anyone else want to try? Oh, we have a lot of volunteers.
I want to break the Kinect.
You want to break the Kinect? Let's do that afterwards. Okay, so that's exciting, right? So do you want to see the robot dance?
Yeah.
Yes, okay, so that would be the last thing we'll do.
Thank you.
goes from top to bottom. In computer science, it's always tricky. Does it go left to right or right to left? So here's a one, a two, and a three. So it makes three. And the second.
How do you generate a random number in Scratch?
One.
I know that.
How many bits are in a byte?
1,000, right?
Yeah. What's 3 in byte?
Oh, 0x0. No, 0101. Sounds like that.
Do you know who invented program?
I don't know.
Let's see. Do you want to say one of these words? See if we can get one of these words? Say that. See if we can get that top one.
Have fun, do stuff, and say something.
Awesome.
I'm going to ask you a couple of questions. And so, like, for example, can you read this word?
I can.
Lopa do the macho cella.
Lopada do macho cella.
Alright, we have a couple of things to do before we start giving out prizes, which will be super exciting. First of all, have everyone get really quiet for a second. Alright, if you are below a fifth grader and you still came today and competed, I want you to stand up. Alright, we have to give them a round of applause, because that's amazing. Alright, you guys are super impressive, so thank you so much for coming. Second of all, we're going to do a quick little activity. On the count of three, I want you all to scream, "I love computer science."
Including parents.
Including parents. All right, are you ready? This has to be super, super loud, okay? One, two, three. Very nice, very nice. All right, who's ready to get some prizes? Yeah. Okay. So, once you guys get quiet, all right, this is what's going to happen. So, we're going to announce the top three for fifth and sixth and the top three for seventh and eighth in both the team competitions and the individual competitions, and then the top two for the original project design. All right, and parents, if your child wins a prize, feel free to come up and take a picture. It'll be a little graduation diploma moment. It'll be really cute. All right, we're going to start with the team competition.
Okay, so in our team, sixth grade and under, our third place team was Kokanee. Come on up, get prizes.
Team Kokanee.
Team Kokanee, where are ya? Come on, get a plaque.
Friendly.
Act like you like each other.
One, two, three.
I will. All right.
Congratulations.
Okay, our second place in sixth grade and under is actually a team that was formed today that didn't even practice together before, and it's Christopher, Ethan, and Justin.
Make the stupidest button you want.
Okay.
One.
Good job. And our first place team in sixth grade and under is the Coding Wizards.
Woo!
Are they here? Coding Wizards? First place? No one? All right. We'll find them after. Okay, so 7th and 8th grade, 3rd place, just scratching the surface. All right, in second place in 7th and 8th grade, we have team FR71. And in first place for 7th and 8th grade is Team Beefalo. So now it's time for the individual competition awards. For 6th grade and under, in 3rd place with a score of 84, which is fantastic, is Brandon Kyung. Alright, in second place, just above him with an 85, is Belle Pan. Pan. Woo! And in first place, with a score of 87, is Nicholas Sarui. Sorry guys, my name's pretty hard too. All right. For 7th and 8th grade, in 3rd place, so they were scored on out of a higher number, so the scores were pretty much equivalent, which is amazing. So in 3rd place with a score of 82 is Daniel Wang. In second place, with a score of 92, is Karthik Lata. And in first place, with a score of 93, is Ben Lees. Last up, Frances is going to announce the original design project.
Hi, guys. So before, we're going to have a second place and a first place. Before I get to that, I'd like to mention some honorable mentions we had. Ian Hutchinson with his artificially intelligent tic-tac-toe game. The Conquistadors with their very complex scrolling platformer that had original sound and art. And they demonstrated some good teamwork, splitting up their work. And then Yusuf Haredi, who wrote a game to bring attention to global warming. It's really cool. Oh, yeah, stand up.
Yeah. Are you guys
stand
here?
Up if you were on?
Stand up, yeah. Okay, so before we announce the winners, I just wanted to say that this was our first year doing this period, so this was, we had no idea what to expect when we were judging these original projects, but we were all floored by what you guys came up with, so choosing the winners was very difficult, and like I said, it ranged from like really, really creative projects to incredibly technically difficult, and you guys all put in so much work, so you should all be really proud of yourselves regardless. So thank you, it was so much fun to do this.
Okay, in second place, we have Technos and Pixels with Into the Clouds. So, come up. So their project utilized some hardware where they actually made some physical controls for their game. They made a physical arrow keys that they pressed that completed circuits and sent signals to their computer, and then they made a maze game that was actually very, very well done and very complete. Good job.
All right, and in first place, we have Jack Mandelkorn with Spectrum. So Jack's project, it looks like this, and it renders 3D shapes that you can manipulate and turn and stretch, and he explained all the math to me. It was very complicated, and we were very impressed.
Hey, we'd like to hire you.
All right, a couple of quick announcements. Number one, there was a phone found, so if anyone is missing a phone, please come find me. Okay. And
it's back.
And a bag. And on the
first bag, too.
And we're gonna have Victor come say a few final words in closing. So thank you everyone for coming. It was amazing. We had a great day.
I just have a couple of things to say. One is to the parents. So I think, I don't know if you guys know, but computer science enrollments are going up massively in almost every university that I know of. And because the potential to do amazing thing has become much more than it ever was in this field. So I think your kids are all in the right place, right track. And just know that computer science does not mean just that you sit in front of a computer and program all day long and you come back and you become a nerd or anything like that. It actually means, like we say, it's a way of thinking. It's a way of breaking down complex problems into its logical entities and then trying to go after them. And that skill can be applied anywhere in any field. Some of the greatest advances that are happening are in the medical sciences, for example, in biomedicine, in biocomputing, where you're actually looking at societal problems that are going to be solved because you're going to be able to bring computers and the horsepower of many, many servers in the cloud to solve these problems. And you kids, you guys are going to do that. You guys are going to solve the problems that our generation could not solve. And that's because you think like that. You think about big data. You think about lots of amazing amount of data that comes from different places, and you correlate that data and you find some inference out of that. And that inference will now solve these problems. So this is a first step. I hope you had a good time. What I want to actually do is get all the volunteers up here who have worked pretty hard to make this all happen. So if you're a volunteer, just come on up here. So. So there isn't enough I can say about these guys. They have been up late at nights. They have prepared the questions. They have tested them again and again. They were much more passionate than I could have ever imagined. Couldn't have worked with a better group of people. We really appreciate them. So just a loud applause to all these guys.